Well, there's a bridge and there's a river that I still must cross as I'm going on my journey. Though I might be lost, and there's a road I have to follow, a place I have to go. Well, no one told me just how to get there.
Hi, my name is Anne Welsh. You've just been listening to the show. I hope you enjoyed it. I did. It was great. Now we've created awareness about sickle cell and disorder. I am an author. I've just written a new book called Painless, which is about my invisible battle of living with pain and finding joy. You can find out all my details on www.annewelsh.com or at Instagram, Lady Anne Welsh. I hope you enjoyed the show. Thank you.
I'm founder and director of SickleKan Sickle Cell Foundation. I'm here on the Effiong-Jones show. Thank you for having me. It's a good time. And you can contact us at www.sicklekan.com. Our handles on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook are SickleKan with a hyphen at the end. And you can just contact us, follow us, and we'll be able to help support you.
I think those were the guys who were in the mobile phone. So I'm just saying, find a way to contact my mother, call 911, I call the emergency service, I need to get out of here. Wow. It just kept getting worse, I'm breathing difficulties and all of this, so yeah. It's
been 50-50 when it comes to dating sickle cell, because of the fact that from outward appearance, I don't look physically sick to people, so they tend to either be shocked, or they tend to be like, oh, what do I do? They tend to be, you know, perplexed. So I would say that, me personally, I'm of an opinion that if someone chooses sickle cell not to date me, then that's their problem, not mine. Bearing in fact that they don't either have the full-blown condition or have the trait, then to me personally, I see it as if it's their loss. But okay. I do understand that the struggles that many people have when it comes to disclosing that they have sickle cell.
Okay, African background. I don't want to say Nigerians specifically.
No, I don't
let's just say African background. But one thing that's very common with Africans is if somebody's got sickle cell, it's almost like you can't marry that person. You can't have children with that person. I really want to go there. It's a hard conversation to have. But I want to go there. Do you understand what I mean? Because it's real. You know. And how do you react to that? Or how do you... That might not be your story, but what do you think? What would you say to parents?
The community about sickle cell, I feel as if their knowledge is very lacking. And it's lacking for the fact that our older generation used to use it as a crutch. Used to use it as advice for sickle cell patients instead of actually offering lending support and help for sickle cell patients. And if you were to look it back into Nigeria now, at the moment time, there's very much hasn't changed when it comes to raising awareness, supporting those within the community. Sickle cell is still treated as something that's basically something that's deserved because that person is either cursed.
Yes.
And I feel as if.
Or like my sister tried to make out like I'm naughty.
Yeah, it's something that, you know, we can't move on as a community and we can't champion awareness if we don't start the action ourselves. And I feel as if we cannot then expect the wider community to say, you know what, let's talk about sickle cell, let's get awareness out there if we ourselves as a community are not talking about it. And that stems from the older generation. Like my parents, I know my dad to this day still doesn't talk about sickle cell trait.
Okay.
So my firstborn was born with a trait. Secondborn, she was born with full-blown sickle cell.
Okay.
But however, when it comes to how my daughter's affected, she's hardly any affected. Only thing that affects her is just the tiredness.
That's it. She's got you as a dad.
She don't normally get the joint pain. She don't get the pains. It's just the tiredness and the fatigue. That's it. But however, I'm making it clear that she can speak about her condition. She can speak to her classmates about sickle cell disease because, to me personally, that's the only way we can get awareness out there. And I feel as if it needs to be coming from our own community, from sickle cell warrior, to say that, you know what, just because I have sickle cell doesn't mean this is the picture of me. This is not the picture of me being hospital. It doesn't represent who I am as a sickle cell warrior. And I feel like we need more people basically that are living with the condition to just say, you know what, this is the condition that affects me. There are times that I'm going to be sick, but however, there are times that I'm active, I'm working, I'm doing the things that they say that I can't do.
Yeah.
Now, for these images are not out there within the community. It's always doom and gloom. Originated from a sickle cell trait, which protects most Africans from having malaria. Okay, that's the issue that we have. It's here for a reason. Due to the fact that, you know, genes mutate into sickle cell, how sickle cell is now the full-blown condition, and the fact that, you know, migration to the West and colder parts of Europe, we don't have the immunities that often people, sickle cell warriors have in Africa when it comes to having the sun as their major backup. What I'll say at the moment in time is that more we need to speak as a community when it comes to sickle cell. We need to challenge our parents. We need to pass this down to our children to say that, you know what, it's okay to speak about sickle cell. It's okay to actually be aware of the issues facing people that have sickle cell disease. And it's also to talk about the impacts and the relationship aspect when it comes to sickle cell.
Okay. Paula, you are online, on air. Hello, Paula? Hello?
He's got his thing on.
Yes, we can hear you now.
Yeah, it's just like your guest mic
turned
up, you know.
The mic is not turned up?
No, the guest. Yours is alright, but the other ones, we can't hear them.
Oh, you can't hear me.
Right, okay.
Really?
The microphone is turned up.
Can you hear us better?
Can you hear me now? Can CIC, which is a community interest group, and SickleKan Foundation, which is a religious charity, creating them from our own personal experience with sickle cell. Probably about 5 or 6 years ago when I was having back-to-back crisis episodes in hospital, and I felt as if they were treating me for my pain, but they weren't treating me for the mental aspects of dealing with sickle cell. So I'll be in hospital, recover at home, back in hospital, and I just felt as if there has to be a better way of dealing with this because I was suffering from depression, mental health, they almost OD'd on my pain meds, and I just felt as if instead of me channeling that internally, there has to be a better outlet in regards to managing the sickle cell. So I just felt as if the information is not out there.
Hi, Paula, you're on air.
Yeah, I wanted to connect me.
You wanted to connect?
Yes.
Okay, you mean to listen to the show?
Yes.
Right, okay. All right, I'll send you the details to connect.
Okay.
I'll send you the details to connect now.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, you mentioned about almost ODing.
Yeah, that's why I created an organization to basically support other acts, mainly, firstly men, then children, and then the whole community, the local wider community that have sickle cell disease. Because I just felt as if there has to be something from the perspective of sickle cell patients, because everything that we have here is for medical professionals.
Yeah.
And that shows that awareness at the moment time is severely lacking, and more support is needed in regards to support these organizations and individuals that have sickle cell disease. I was having a blood transfusion.
Okay, how does that help?
Basically, what happens is that it filters out the sickle cell blood
right,
in the
okay.
system and it replenishes it with healthy blood.
Okay.
So basically, gives you like a
feel much better. Yeah.
Like an oil change or something, just exactly. replaces the blood in your system with healthy blood.
Okay.
Yes.
And the downside to that is that only 1% of black people are registered to give blood in the UK.
Can you imagine?
Which means supply does not meet demand.
Yeah. Can't be
coming
and,
through,
yeah. And then reject blood, and then it's so difficult because when you're severe sickle cell crisis, especially when they do the blood test and they see your sickle cell count is about 90%, and literally when it's that higher level, they really need to give you blood to get rid of it. But in my case, because no one I do it now, when I was doing the blood, I used to do it every 3 months. You know, because I think the sickle cell blood, the sickle cell red blood cell doesn't last. People with sickle cell, their arteries break somewhat more easily.
Mm.
Yeah, so I used to do it quite often. That's what happened.
So, okay, let me add some more practical questions around the blood giving. So, is it just black?
Cell blood? It's mostly black people that we need other black people.
Asians?
Sickle cell affects black, Asian, and Mediterranean people, but however, when it comes to our community, it affects about 98% of black people. So that's why we're urging for more black blood.
More black blood.
More black and Asian blood. However, when it comes to actually, it's just due to compatibility, and we're just trying to eliminate the chance of the blood being rejected. And it comes to the point where there's a particular type of blood that we particularly need, which is the RO blood type, which is very rare. However, it's gold when it comes to treating people with sickle cell disease.
And there are people out there, some might know that they've got this RO?
Yeah, RO blood subtype, which is gold. It's like gold mine when it comes to transfusions in sickle cell.
So that's really, for me, that's a real call to action.
Of course, but more people.
You said 1% of black people in the UK give blood.
Are registered to give blood.
Are registered to give blood. And even, so registered don't even mean they give it.
Registered to give blood. So what? That's why we've basically, that's another thing that we do with NHS. We, with other organisations, we partnership.
Run maybe regular adverts on people donating blood. So we'll talk to you about that, running some regular jingles to do that.
It can incubate in the system where it's dormant, and then it can come back with that too. You also say that tattoos is about...
Okay, so let me clarify that so people are clear. It's not that if you've been to a country that has malaria, you can't give blood. What they're saying is if you've travelled... and you've recently travelled to a country that has malaria, you kind of have to wait 3 months to give blood. That's what we're saying. So it's not because if you've travelled to somewhere that's got malaria, you can't give blood. So I want to make that very clear.
If you've had the CJD blood trauma, you know, the mad cow disease back in the 90s, early 90s?
Mad cow?
Yeah, you can't give
blood
at all. If you had a blood transfusion in the 90s, you can't give blood either because of the fact that they didn't have the strict testing that they have today. That they do now.
If you've given blood in the 90s,
if you've stolen blood,
taken blood. Yes. Right. If you've had a blood transfusion, received blood yourself.
Yes.
Okay. Got you.
There's also the fact that basically, if you've had tattoos or piercings, there's normally a waiting period. I think that's another 3 month waiting period as well.
Okay.
So it's just TikTok anyway. So if you give blood, they filter it, they test it to make sure that your blood is healthy before it's given to anybody else. So they won't give you any tainted blood without actually double checking, triple checking, and filtering or anything out.
It's managing in sense that if mommy's sick, who takes care of baby? I remember one time I was sick and my boy baby was 6 months. My husband said to me, what happens if we take him with us or do we call your mum to come down and she meets you at the hospital? And I said, look, there's no point bringing him to hospital because he's still quite young. Why not take him along and he will come by later? But at that time, I just realised that I need to make a choice here. Do I involve him with this on this journey, or do I keep him separate from it? And I said, you know, it's always best with kids, also from bully perspective, because I never know where it will happen. And I never know, I talk about it, I'm quite open about sickle cell from day one, I've always been. And I said, from bully any perspective, it's better he knows what it is, rather than him hearing it from outside. Yes. And also, when you come back home, you look all weak, disheveled, just looks so ill. And if he's not part of the journey and all of a sudden I come back home and he sees me like that, I think that would actually scare him. So when I'm in hospital from day one, he always comes and he knows the routine. He knows what to do. He knows when you come see mommy. If mommy doesn't want to eat, you don't force it.
Think it's always a bad idea to hide things from your kids.
I think so.
Money troubles, things. I think it's always a bad idea to. I mean, obviously, in moderation, based on their understanding, let them know what's going on. You know, because didn't you? I mean, let's talk amongst ourselves. As African children, didn't you hate it when your parents would hide certain things? And
of course,
you knew there was something. Yeah, you know, it could be about anything.
And you're just like, Mom, what's the matter? Just tell me what it is. Like, you know, because you just want to know.
Yeah.
And I think, I look so disheveled. I look so slim and just so bad.
Yeah.
Sometimes I come back with injection because I'm just saying to the hospital, enough. I mean, take me home. I've had it.
Yeah.
So you still have all the thing on you and you're throwing up and I said you need to know what mom is going through. Don't be never be embarrassed by it.
And I think in regards to mine, they had to know by force because Angel has sickle cell as well. So it's a situation where if I'm not around, her big brother has to be able to look after her.
How old are your children?
My son is 9, going to be 10, and my daughter just turned 7.
Okay.
So the fact that my son basically he's the one that's always asking me about sickle cell. He's always inquiring how to help his sister.
Wow.
When it comes to when she's sick. When it comes to my daughter, there's a situation where even though she's not affected by sickle cell to a certain extent, she's able to talk about it. She's able to go into school, talk about briefly about sickle cell. And she's also able to help me because I tend to have more of an affliction with sickle cell than she does.
Mm-hmm.
So she kind of tends to know what I go through, and she tends to help me out when it comes to medication,
okay.
You know, healthy eating. She's like my mom, basically, when it comes to my health, monitoring my health. So I just feel these things are empowering them. So when it, if they want to take over the reins when it comes to the charity or awareness about sickle cell, they've got a healthy head start when it comes to doing that. So I think that's a great way to start with kids.
Okay, we've got about 10 minutes left, so I'm just going to, I had questions. What I've always been told is the life expectancy of somebody with sickle cell condition is short.
How long I live. Yes. I'm in charge of, you know, my health. I'm in charge of how long I live.
Yeah.
And there's also, there's some instances in Nigeria that the oldest woman with sickle cell is 96.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, you know, it's something that I don't let labels control or dictate what I do.
Yeah.
To me, it's nothing, you get me? You know, at the end of the day, there's a lot of people that live in old age that have sickle cell disease.
So as an adult, you can say that, but growing up as... Okay, so you didn't quite know until you were in your 20s
about sickle cell. Yeah, but I did have health conditions. So I did have health conditions, but however, that was mainly due to the fact that I wasn't on medication.
Right,
so I would say, even though there's no cure to sickle cell besides the bone marrow transplant, medication has improved. From 30 years ago,
right.
There's people that can take folic acid daily. They can take penicillin, you know, which increases the red blood cell count. They can, penicillin for immune system, folic acid for red blood cell count. There's so many things that you can take now that you can take natural supplements that aid your health. So for me personally, there's more things available now than they were back in the day.
Yeah.
When it comes to, and plus people are living healthier. But however, when it comes to sickle cell disease, I always say now, you champion your health. There's certain people that are affected worse sickle than other people, but however, to me, no one can dictate to me how long I live at all. Never, unless they're God, they can't tell me anything.
And is this the same for you?
It was slightly different because I grew up here in some parts of Nigeria, and my dad was always aware that his friends were always telling that she would live only to 21, so enjoy it. So I used to hear all this whisper that, she's so weak. You know, in my book, I did talk about when my brother passed away and how people assume it should be me because I was the one that had this sickle cell. So I wasn't going to be any use to society. So why the hell is she still around?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when the healthy one who was perfectly child, AA, passed away. So that really affected my parents because they thought they'd been robbed by God by keeping me alive and taking away this boy.
Wow.
You know, my dad will never come out to say that. But
there was an expectation
everyone, you know, our nannies that were looking after us, people around, you know, you could hear the whisper that, you know, why is this passing? And so you always know, and it was terrible. He was our only brother.
Yeah.
So we didn't have another brother, so it's just him. You know, so when that happened, that gave me some perspective of life. Like, what the hell is this life all about? Why? What am I living with? Because they never would talk about it as deep as I would want them to. But it did affect me. But I got back past a certain age and I realized that, you know, what is really death? People die from anything anyway. I've met so many people who've died from not just having sickle cell, but having other illnesses. And I realized that I can't be afraid of the journey of my life. I need to be able to control my world and believe that what will be, and what will not be my own destiny. And then when I also realized that for me to be have gone through so much of that I've been through over the years, and I'm still standing and still standing strong, and I'm here for a destiny. There's a reason I'm here. And my parents have actually come to accept that it's actually not the illness anymore. Yeah.
Okay, quickly, I want to talk about what you've got. If you can quickly just tell people about what you have this weekend happening.
this weekend I'm going to Sickle Cell and they have an event going on tomorrow. I will be there to support them and I'm really excited about that. That's actually tomorrow.
Yeah.
Then on Saturday on 6th of July, which is actually my birthday.
Wow.
Yeah, I decided to just do it on my birthday. I'll be at W.H. Smith Red Cross signing books.
Okay, what time are you going to be there?
I'll be there from 11 onwards.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'll be there for 2 hours. Yeah.
Okay.
So I have a number of things going on with guiding the book promotion because I want more people to talk about and understand what we've been through.
Okay.
Yeah.
And yes, tell us about your event.
Right, we have a talent show case event tomorrow. Basically, we're raising awareness for sickle cell disease. So we're just going to have people. Plus, your community just showed showcasing their talents. It's tomorrow in Croydon, so Alchemy Bar in Croydon. Tickets are still available, so you guys get your tickets. It's a joint event with the Michael Street Foundation, basically. And to me, it's just going to be an event that's just showcasing different talents. We also have another blood drive in Peckham on the 19th of July, so Peckham Rye Church. So make sure you get there. You can register at www.blood.co.uk and then you can even contact us on Instagram and then we can book you in a slot, definitely. So to me personally, it means a lot for people to come out and give blood. There's going to be other blood drives in the year. We're going to have one in Brixton, have one. So I just say, moment in time, if you want to know more, visit www.blood.co.uk or visit our website, www.sicklecan.com.
Okay, if you didn't catch all that information, don't worry too much. I will be posting something between today and tomorrow. We'll give you all the, well, probably tonight I'll post it. So you have all the information you need for the event tomorrow and for the book signing on Saturday. Okay, and all the information about where to donate blood. I also want to say thank you and give a really warm thank you and shout out to those who donated money. Because I just clicked a foundation, Sickle Cell Foundation, not thinking people would donate, but people actually went on and donated money for that foundation. So I just say thank you to those who did that on Facebook.
Thank you.
I also need you, if you haven't donated, I'm going to be sharing the link to donate money to SickleKan Foundation. Okay, I'll be sending sharing that in my information thing that I share and stuff. Tomorrow I will be registering to donate blood. I'll definitely, that's my call to action. I'm going to do that and we'll be working with you to see how we can get some more awareness on the show. Saturday, please be at the book signing at Brent Cross Shopping Center, W.H. Smith. I'll be there and be there, so you know, so it'll be nice to see you all down there to get your book signed.
And don't forget tomorrow, Alchemy Bar, Croydon.
Yes, and don't forget tomorrow, Croydon. Again, I'll be sharing all those details later on. Thank you all for joining. I totally appreciate you, and I totally appreciate all the good work that people are doing. And thank you for coming. Kehinde, thank you for coming.
I
appreciate all the good work you're doing out there. So it's the weekend. Take care of yourself. Look more into how you can help and further this cause a bit better.
Media Radio, 104.1 FM.
And that's us out. Hi guys, I am Asia Effiong-Jones. Thank you for watching and supporting my channel. Please do like and subscribe and leave your comments below.